I would like to start today by acknowledging the traditional custodians of the lands on which I live, work and play, and that is the Dja Dja Wurrung people of the Kulin Nation, and to pay my respects to their elders past, present and emerging. I'm super excited to have Jess Racklyeft here with us today, and I'm going to just read you a quick little bio so we can put you in the picture. Jess is an illustrator and more recently author based in Melbourne, Australia, and working from a very messy studio at the back of her house. She has always drawn and over the last 10 years has been working full-time as an illustrator, primarily in picture books. Sometimes she has other projects on the go, such as greeting card designs, working with awesome clients, or creating stuff for her own Etsy shop. She loves working with watercolors and digital illustration and finds inspiration in the laneways and city, as well as Mary Creek, and trips out of town to the beautiful countryside surrounding Melbourne. Jess's recent awards, and she has many awards if you go to her website and have a look, but there's a big one at the moment, which is the CBCA, the Children's Book Council of Australia, winner of Picture Book of the Year, and also notable for the Eve Pownell Award for Iceberg, which is her beautiful, beautiful book written by Claire Saxby and published by Allen and Unwin in 2022. So we are so, congratulations, Jess. It's so hard won and so well deserved. And I'm just really thrilled to be able to talk to you today.
Thanks, Jen. I'm really excited to be here. I've watched all your videos and you know how much I love all the work that you do. So,
no, thank you. So, Jess, I want to start off, as I always do, by taking you back to where you say you've always drawn. So what were your family circumstances? How did you emerge as an artist?
Yeah, so I my dad wanted to be a poet and then he became a dentist. And my mum studied graphic design, but then she had kids way too young and then she was working for dad's dental surgery. So it was weird. I realised recently I'm like their repressed combos has become my work. But mum was very creative and she always would just lay out tables of like glitter and clay and paint when we were kids. And it was the 80s, so we were very neglected, so we just spent hours drawing away. And they were both quite interesting characters. Like dad was a bit of a wild dentist. He did he partied a lot. He did lots of triathlons. He did the Ironman, which is crazy, like a 4K swim and a marathon and 140 kilometer ride. Like he did that several times. He was just quite wild. And then yeah, we grew up in Perth, and every weekend we go to this little windsurfing town about 2 hours north of Perth, and it was very windy and isolated, and my sister and I loved it, and then as teenagers hated it, and now we kind of love it again. They've still got it. So it was a very fun Perth upbringing, and lots of outdoors and lots of ocean time and lots of drawing. And then I always like doodled at school and would have little notebooks, and just I would take in information when teachers were talking by drawing at the same time, which, you know, you're not really allowed to do at that time. I think people are a bit more accepting of it now, but I loved it. And then I had really arty friends, and I think I felt I wasn't very, compared to them, I didn't feel very good. And then I was quite good at science and math, so I ended up kind of giving away art in year 10 and then studying more, and thought I'd become a marine biologist. And then after about a year of that, I realized at uni that I wasn't going to be able to float around with dolphins, and then that was going to not be quite the dream I had hoped. So I ended up changing to a media arts degree, and I did things like computer internet groups and cultural studies, which were all outdated in about 6 months of finishing my degree. So I was a bit of a lost case, and I didn't really know what I was going to do. And so I ended up traveling quite a lot, and then after a few years of traveling, ended up in Melbourne and got a job at Lonely Planet in customer service. So that was my first kind of inroad into publishing, and that was probably now like about, oh my god, it sounds so long ago, I was gonna say 15, but it's more like 18 years ago. Ooh. And then I got a job finally at 5 Mile Press doing co-edition. So I was selling their children's books to overseas publishers. And I did that for about 3 years, and I got to go to book fairs and get to know children's book publishing much more. And I was still drawing on the side. I still had like these kind of hopes and dreams, but I was just working away. And then I left 10 years ago to have my daughter. And when I was on maternity leave, I was like, this is my time to make a break for it. I have to really give this a good crack. So I was one of those crazy, like, half slept like baby and beyond drawing and just sending stuff everywhere, and it sort of started working, and I realized that I wasn't going to have to go back to my old job. So that's how that it went, that way, and then ended up on the illustration path when I was on the cabin. Yeah,
but it could kind of see the universe was steering you. And also, it's really interesting. I didn't realize you had a Perth and seaside sort of background, and that really comes through in your style and in your voice of your illustrations. And now with Iceberg,
yeah,
it's kind of like it was written in the sands, you know, that this was going to happen.
Yeah, it was kind of funny because I did a lot of the background work for that. We go to Perth every second year for Christmas and up to that beach shack, and it is very, it's obviously not Antarctica, but it does have this sense of isolation, and it's on the edge of the sea, so you just look out to blue. And I was doing all the early sketches there and watching David Attenborough documentaries about Antarctica. And so it's funny that you say that, because I didn't really think about that, but it probably has flowed through somehow to the pages.
Yeah, and of course your approach to watercolor and you know, there's a lot, the imagery is very loose and watery and dreamy in all your books. So we'll get further into that in a minute, but that's a super, super interesting background. Did you have siblings, Jess?
Yes, I've got a sister who's 18 months younger, and she actually studied viticulture, and now she's a dog groomer. So we've both got very weird, and she's still in Perth. So, and my dad now lives in Tasmania, and he comes up every now and then. And yeah, my mum and all my cousins and everything are in Perth, so we're kind of all over the place. But it's
right. And how many children do you have?
I've got two.
You've got two.
Yeah.
And were they born close together?
No, 3 years apart.
That's close.
Yeah. I mean, when I hear it, yeah. Some people squeezing them in like mum did 18 months, I'm like, oh, they're close enough.
Jess, sorry, I just wanted to ask you while I've caught you in this family trap. One of the things that is a great challenge for a lot of people in Girl and Dark, the younger ones with young families, is this juggle. And this desire to chase your dream, but also this desire to be heavily involved in your children's life. Yeah. So have you got any tips, or can you explain to us how you juggled all that? Because it seems to me that having your child, your first child, was the turning point for you. Yeah. And it was almost like a point of, I'm going to focus now.
Yeah, I think there's lots of caveats, because I know people have different temperaments. Kids. So some babies sleep and some don't. And mine weren't particularly good sleepers, but I think I was so driven that it gave me the momentum to use that time. And also I never wanted to just quit work and start from scratch and have no income and rely on my partner Matt's income. So that maternity leave gave me like a mental framework for giving it time, even though there was no time, it's in snippets, but I it was like this permission kind of thing. So so my tips for that period, and I would never say if it doesn't feel right, like of course you go, because it's a very tender time and you're pretty raw and emotionally worn thin sometimes with young babies. But I found it really gave me energy to go and do work. And whenever Ivy would sleep, I would be straight into it. And then when she was about 18 months, she started daycare. And so that was 3 days a week. And that was great because it allowed me to actually have proper chunks. It just built up slowly. So it wasn't like I had a full-time career straight away. It was just a few hours here and there from different jobs and then each year as they grew up, I was getting more and more work. And then, yeah, it was definitely, there was times that it was hard. I found it really hard in lockdown because Matt's a teacher, so he would have to be teaching his kids on Zoom during the day. And then when he had time, he would be taking our youngest one who was in prep, who we gave up pretty quickly because he just hated homeschooling. So we just, they go out for walks, and then I would be taking turns crying, trying to do her homeschooling. And then I have to do books still. So I'd be getting up at 4 a.m. and doing a few hours of work. And then so that was pretty tough. So I just think you've got to go with the flow and what feels right. But I think, it is a really fertile creative time as well. I think people either find it gives them heaps of creative energy or wipes out their creative energy, but I found that that time gave me a lot.
Also gives them focus, by the sounds of things, for you in your case, because suddenly your time was limited.
And I think also if I hadn't have had the 10 years working in other jobs and publishing, and by the time I left publishing I was pretty over it, but if I hadn't have had that 10 years of learning how to work hard and learning more about publishing and learning what it means to be in an office for 8 hours a day and working for a pretty low wage, if I hadn't have built all those skills and realised what that was, I'd be a very different illustrator now. Like, I'd probably be a bit more loose about my time and waiting for creative inspiration. Like, I hear people say, oh, you've got to wait for the creative inspiration, and I'm like, no, that's not a thing for me. I'm just get down and do it, and I treat it like a real job, and it's a really fun job, but I appreciate, like, I have to, there's got to be a good output. You have to be really easy to work with. You have to be on top of all your admin and all that sort of stuff, because I think I learned those skills in my previous work. So it was beneficial doing a lot of other random jobs before I started this one.
When you were working in publishing, you weren't actually in design or anything in publishing, were you? So what was going on with your, I'm really interested in your illustration and art in the background, you know, what was going on there?
Yeah, it was pretty just night times, and I even wasn't really allowed to talk about it at my second job, especially because it was very like, oh, the focus is the job. If they knew that that was a side interest, it would seem like I'm dissing my job. I don't know. I felt like I wasn't allowed to talk about it. Even though I was in a children's book company, I kept it pretty under wraps if I wanted to illustrate and I wanted to do these other things. And I knew I wasn't at that stage either. So I would tinker, and I had portfolios, and I think I may have even sent some stuff out.
Can I just interrupt you there? How did you know that you weren't at that stage? That's really interesting.
I think, I you know that Ira Glass, beautiful poem that he says about being able to see work and knowing. I just could see it, and I knew it wasn't good enough. And I probably, I think when you're in it, like I look back now and I go, it was even worse than what I thought it is now. Like at the time I thought it was pretty bad, but I knew I kind of thought it was okay. Now I look and I'm like, oh no, it was very bad. It was, like I couldn't stop myself because I loved it, but I knew I wasn't.
That is beautiful. You couldn't stop yourself because you loved it. I mean, that's key, isn't it? It's so key. And so can you remember what your first job was as an illustrator and how you felt?
So I think I maybe got a few little tiny jobs, like doing cards for a company, and but I sent out my portfolio, and there was this lovely lady at Omnibus when they were in South Australia, and she was the art director, and she that pretty bad portfolio, she wrote back and she said, oh, thank you, it's not quite right for us at the moment, but I can see potential. And that was all I needed, and just a reply. So I kept sending her stuff each year, and then on that first year of maternity leave, I remember being in the backyard, I think Ivy was on me or nearby, and she said, oh, we've got a job for you. And it was with Sally Morgan. And I was like, what the heck? So it was a possum, a book about a nighttime possum. And then I also won, Tanya McCartney had her 52-week challenge, and they had a call out to enter to do a book that she'd written. And I got that in the first year. So I got two first jobs, and that was like, I was like, okay, this is great, it's starting. And a few other little sprinkles of jobs, but it was enough money and enough time that I didn't feel like I had to go back to my old job. So it was a really
That must have been quite huge, though, to take on picture books. It's, you know, you've done some cards and stuff. And did you have a mentor, or did you have someone to guide you?
Yes, lovely Anna Walker. So
she's
become a really good friend, but I knocked on her door, or knocked on her email. I think I wrote to I had very high aspirations. I think I wrote to Freya Blackwood and Anna, and I said, hello, you know, I'm just starting out and I just wondered if I might be able to come and meet you. And Freya wrote back a lovely message and said that she was flat out, and also she's in a different state, so I don't even know how that was going to work. But Anna was like, oh yeah, you could come by. And so I came and I was just like probably speechless or babbling, one of those two. And I just she was just so lovely and had a good look at my work and gave me some amazing pointers. And then every year I would go back and just talk to her about what I'd done and updates, and she gave me really good feedback. And then as the years developed, it became more intertwined with my work. So a few years ago, a firm press hired her to art direct a book I was doing, so that was amazing because we could meet several times through the process.
And which book was that
it was the beginning of that There's Only One Mum Like You series.
Beautiful.
So she pushed me. I think I need pushing, and I don't, if it's just you and you don't know how to push yourself, it was, you can't get to that stage. So it was really helpful because she'd say, oh, I think you should try doing this. And I'd finish something and she might say, oh, you could try this. And I'd be like, oh, I can't be bothered doing it again. Like normally I just send it off, but she'd just say, I think you should try this. And I'd be like, okay, Anna, yes, I will. And it made it so much better. So she's been a major part of me learning and growing, and ever grateful to her. She's just awesome.
Amazing. Anna is amazing. Her work ethic. She did a masterclass for us in the Duck Pond, and it was just, the class itself was like a production. You know, she put so much thought and effort into the class, and then and what we learned and what we saw behind the scenes was just fascinating.
Yeah, she's
so just admirable.
Yeah, her background work for every book is just so diligent, and and she just puts her heart into everything, doesn't she?
Yeah, heart and soul. But as do you, and that's come through, and just watching you, I think I've been watching you. I just watched that creepy thing on Netflix. Watching you from the distance for about 10 years now, probably, you know, when you first sort of started to come onto the scene and started, and you did a Scribbles masterclass with Girl and Duck as well. And so it's been interesting, really interesting to watch your career evolve. And also the thing I'm really love about you is how you're very prolific, but you've also, you've done this dance of diversifying, and I'd love to talk to you a little bit more about that, because you have an Etsy shop, right? And it's not just an Etsy shop. It's, you know, with a couple of trinkets in it. It's very well stocked with beautiful, beautiful things. And that in itself is a lot of work. You know, it's you've got to produce the items for the shop, but then you've got to monitor the shop and do all the behind the scenes stuff, customer care and client liaison and the techie and blah blah blah. So you're able to juggle all this sort of stuff, so can you talk to us about that?
I think I have work it gives me a lot of energy, and I get ideas that excite me, and then I try and follow them, and selling stuff and I'll just randomly go, oh, I really want to make a pin or whatever, and then they can't, sometimes they take off and sometimes they don't, but it's just, it's really, it gives me a lot of excitement and energy. And it's so nice when people do order direct and you can send them a little package and wrap it up. But yeah, I think books are obviously my main focus, but I do try and treat illustration as a career as being multifaceted for me. Like I don't think I could earn all my income from just doing books, and I'm really dedicated to earning a good income as an arts worker. So I knew that early on, and so then I was like, okay, well, I've got to have my fingers in lots of pies, because I know some will go up and some will go down. And so there's like Etsy shop was one thing, and I would just get excited to make new things, and some would bomb but some would be great. And then I did portraits for quite a few years, and that was good for building up skills drawing too, But then when they became too much, or I kind of lost my passion for them, I just stopped them and changed direction slightly. But yeah, so there's Etsy shop, there's books, there's, I work with some good clients. Like, I work for the Australian Childhood Foundation, so they do resources for social workers and counsellors about working with kids and sometimes quite horrible situations, but trying to break down their work and their documents and undoing drawings for situations of family violence and things like that. So it's quite challenging and different, but it's a really interesting and quite stable part of my work is doing projects with them. And I've had longer term relationships with brands like Urs Wilder that do big brooches. Mm-hmm. And that was really fun. And I would just try and be really good and easy to work with. But then after a few, you know, with Urs Wilder, like, it was great fun, but it was becoming more of a, oh God, I'm getting stressed about it. And it's clashing with some of my other work. So I actually saw a business coach around then, and she said, we've got to like have some boxes for each client. And it's like, do they pay well? Are they great to work with? I think it was, does the work fill you with joy or something like that? I can't remember. And you do ticks, and like, they have to at least have two ticks. And so it was like, I scaled back some things and enhanced others according to, you know, if they kind of fit into a nice working relationship at that time. So yeah, I've got kind of changed and moved around, but I like testing out new things. And
I love that. So yeah. you have lots of relationships going on in your life. You have lots of interests, and even though from the outside it looks like you've got an iron in a lot of fires, which you have, but you're also very strategic by the sounds of it. And the other thing I admire here is that you actually sought help. You said you've got a business mm-hmm. coach. She helped you with the ticking of the boxes, which is it's so vital to have that sort of clarity around your work, especially when you're doing work of the nature that illustrators do.
Yeah.
And not allow yourself to be boxed in because that can be so depleting. And the last thing you want to do, of course, is lose your passion.
Totally.
Yeah.
I did forget a side backstory, but when I moved to Melbourne, I was a bit adrift and I studied kinesiology. Have you ever been?
Yeah.
And that was really interesting just for, I didn't do it for a job, but I did it for just more social, spiritual kind of development. But I found that quite interesting. And yeah, I think that helped me work out being a bit more in touch with what feels right and going with your gut for things. And I have found that that has paid off over time. It's not like you exactly know what the right next step is always, but I've had a pretty lucky run, and I think some of that's got to do with working hard and then matching up with the right kind of work partner.
Working hard and also listening hard to your own feelings and it's been extraordinary to watch you blossom. Board books.
Yeah.
Tell us about board books, because there's a lot of interest in board books.
Yeah, well, I think Tash from Affirm Press is amazing, because she's very strong. She's got a background in marketing, and she saw the Things I Love series and was like, oh, these are great, and they've done well, but I think we should try them in this condensed size. And so all the work was already done, and she just worked out that they packaged them smaller and changed the dimensions. And it was like the books are brand new again and had a whole second life. So that was incredible. And, yeah, I find board books really interesting. I think for publishers, and this is from my working for a publisher, it's quite expensive for them to just do them as a first run. So I think it makes sense sometimes that they do them as a secondary market, once a book's been out as a normal traditional book.
And been proven to be successful. Yeah, so there's already a market there.
Yeah, but they do, and they look so cute. When you've got little kids, it's like so nice to buy them little board books. They make lots of sense. I think they even said it was an accident that the Things I Love series, when they turn into board books, I don't know if they plan for them to be that kind of wood-free stock, like they're not shiny, but I really love that because it makes them feel more like a classy gift, but they're also a board book.
It's really, yeah, yeah. There's one of your board books, and here's my scribbled notes here, that I noticed comes with a stuffed toy too. What was that
Oh,
one?
yeah, that's the baby. I've
The
got it
baby
up there.
ones. Yeah, it's gorgeous.
Yeah, I'll see if I can. Do you want me
Yeah, 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 yeah. Because some
to?
people will be watching this on YouTube, others will be on the potty. But if you're on the podcast, I invite you to imagine.
Oh, yeah. Oh, and now my camera's going to, I have to move it really fast.
Oh, because you've got the blurry background on. Yeah,
sorry.
Yeah.
I can't show you how messy it is because I'm preparing for the big design market and it's chaos.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and that one actually, it's a shrunken picture book.
What's it called again, Jazz?
It's the Welcome
Jazz?
Baby.
Welcome Baby. Yeah. Welcome to the world, isn't it?
Yeah.
Welcome Baby. Yeah.
And they did a condensed picture book and a toy, and it's boxed up, and it's gone really well, especially at like Big W and the chain stores. So that's
I was
been
going to say, where is it selling? So
yeah,
so you've got into the chains, which is just such a coup, isn't it? And
a big
percentage of the market.
I'm trying to learn more about it because I think I live, you know, right next to the little book room and reading.
Yeah.
So it's like I never go. Well, I do go, but it's a more rare occurrence. But it's kind of interesting because my sister lives in more out of town of Perth, and that is their local shopping centre.
Yeah,
And I talked
that's
to Tasha
right.
about how that is, for most places in Australia, that's where people go to buy books and everything. So it's
it's
like
a reality that we all have to embrace. Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I
if
have
we
to.
want to survive, you know, financially. Yeah.
Totally. Especially tough at the moment. So I think, it's great to have work in those places that the royalty might not be the same because of all the.
Yeah,
they earn less and they sell for less and all that sort of stuff, but I think they do get out to a much bigger audience, and it's just really nice to have your cat is so cute.
Oh, she's very naughty.
Yeah, so it's been great. So I really appreciated having this second life and a different avenue to sell things.
And that's the other thing I really gleaned from talking to you is also that you would have what we say multiple income streams, and that's vital to keeping you afloat. Even Sean Tan, who did a masterclass for us a couple of months ago, was sort of shaking his head and saying, I don't know how anyone can survive on the income from picture books alone.
Yeah, I think
it's you know,
yeah,
it's not possible. It's just not possible.
Yeah. And then I think someone like him who does such detailed work and may only have like a couple of books a year, and the likelihood that that's going to be enough to live off is
you can be a household name and still be so this multiple income streams, diversifying, being strategic about what you're doing, these are all things that I get from talking to you and from watching you with your work. Now, what else have I got here that I wanted to ask you about? I just want to go back again to, because it's a concern for a lot of emerging illustrators, this whole idea of finding your style.
Yeah.
You have a very, very distinct style. Can you tell us, one, how you sort of arrived on that, and two, do you ever get tempted to go to try other things?
Yeah. It's funny because I just did some videos for the Storybox Library that are going to be about finding your style. And my message on that was that I don't think you find your style finds you. Like it was, I don't think I set out and go, oh, I want it to look like this and keep practicing drawing things in this way. And then, you know, I think it's more if you keep drawing a lot, then you become more natural at it. And because you're more natural at it, it falls into a certain style of a way of doing things. And even I find like I change mediums a bit more now, like, so I don't just do watercolors, but I'm doing more digital or printmaking or whatever. I don't consciously go, oh, okay, I'm gonna try and keep to my style. I just draw it and then the medium changes, but the style does seem to be pretty consistent. And I think it's just from doing a lot again and again. I'm doing a book now that's really really digital, graphic, big bold chunky colors, and big eyes with the big white eyeballs, and I don't usually do that, but I still think it does look sort of my I think I can still see a similarity, But I used to stress about style a lot, and I would be like, oh, I don't know what my style is. And but then other people would see it and they would say, oh, no, you've definitely got one. And I'd be like, oh, cool. Okay, that's good. But I think if you're just drawing a lot and experimenting, and then you end up following what feels more natural and right for you, that it just emerges. And I think it's probably not, I understand it's not great to have like, yeah, super detailed technical stuff next to maybe big graphic, simple things in your portfolio. But I think if you just make a lot of stuff and then maybe from that find what you really like and choose a selection of stuff to show people that you'd love to do again and again for books, then that's a good way to sort of start building something that has a bit of continuous.
Do you actually now draw for pleasure behind the scenes?
Yeah, not as much, because I think I used to a lot, but I've tried to stop working so much. So I'd work all day, and then I would the kids would crash, and then we'd be watching Netflix, and then I would doodle on my iPad and stuff, and I would enjoy it. But I think I'm just trying to now, after COVID and stuff, have more of a mental break from drawing at all. So I'm not doing as much fun stuff. But at the same time, when I do get really bored, I do stuff. And in lockdown, I started doing these massive paintings, which are so different for me. And they're the one thing that I say to everyone, oh, I don't have to be in the illustration mode to illustrate. I just go and do it. But painting, I have to be in a certain mood to do them. Otherwise, all I look bad. But that's kind of been more of a stress relief change of pace for me, and that's been really fun.
Yeah. Are you working in oils with that? I noticed that you had dabbled with oils a bit.
Yeah, I did an oil painting class like a long time ago, and I love it, and I love the smell of it, and I love the history of it, and it's but it's very messy and kind of difficult, and I'd get paint all over me, and it was just terps, and I'd be like, oh,
so yeah.
Better for me. But I think it's more of a fun stress relief, and that's been, rather than doing more illustration for fun, that's probably been more of the focus.
What about life drawing, Jess? Have you done much life drawing, and do you enjoy it?
I do enjoy it. I haven't done enough, and I'm pretty clunky at drawing humans, so I probably should do more. I enjoy it. Again, it's the last 10 years it's been kids and work and a bit of fun with friends, so I haven't had much, but I think that's another thing I'd like to do more regularly. I did one at the Abbotsford Convent recently. That was really nice.
Who did you do that with?
I can't remember her name, but it's a super trendy, like everyone was like hip 25 to 30 year old, and they had wine and and they had like a DJ.
My goodness, wow.
It was really fun, but I was like, this is probably a bit too hip for my not just drink wine and talk about philosophy or something. I think I should get back into it, but I think it's another thing to be done.
It's always really interesting, and you know, there's different schools of thought out there, you know, and you often hear people say, oh, you can't be an illustrator until you've been doing, you know, life drawing for bloody 20 years or something. And I think that's just these rules, I don't know where they come from, but they scare people and they demotivate people. And it's good to hear that, you know, yes, you dabbled, but, you know, you're focusing on this other stuff.
Yeah, so. I think that's why mainly I do animals. I sometimes have to do more humans, and I'm slowly chipping away at that, but I enjoy doing animals more as human characters, because
and they come through with such quirk, and they're so uniquely you. They're just beautiful.
I think it feels more natural, but I enjoy, again, it's kind of nice learning. So I did a course online that someone I know did about drawing human figures. And that was good. So I think, it's fun to have things to work on that you enjoy and know that you have to get better at. So like writing is one, drawing humans is one, and there's a few others.
So can you talk to us a little bit more about the writing, because you segued into that. You started off, like many illustrators, illustrating other people's words, and then starting, and you're still doing that, but you're also doing writing your own beautiful books on the side. So can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so I Yeah, so I think I'd done about, I can't remember how many books, but it was probably about 5 years in. And then I met with a firm press, and they said, "Oh, I think you can write one, give it a crack." And I was like, "Oh, no, thank you." And they're like, "No, no, just do it. You write funny emails, I'm sure, you just give it a go." And I was like, "Oh, okay." So I did the Things I Love series, which are very cheesy, and they're not a narrative story. It's like a bit more of a poem about, the things that you love about a mum or a dad or whatever. And so that was really fun and great that it worked and they sold well. And I was like, "Oh, okay." And so I did lots of courses. So I did your course. I did a short course at the what's the one in the city? Sue De Janeiro was doing one that I see.
The Australian Writers Centre.
Oh no, it's the adult CAE.
Oh, okay, CAE, yeah. Right, yeah.
A few years ago, but yep. That was really good. And then, I still find it very intimidating, but I think I'm just, again, like keep chipping away. And then next year I've got my first proper narrative story coming out, so it was like it's a bit more of a arc. And, again, I've had wonderful editors helping me, but that's
so who are you working on that with, Jess?
So it's with Ellen and Unwin, and I had Davina Bell, who's a lovely
beautiful friend. Yeah,
she was editing it, and Nicola Santilli, and so they've been really helpful. And and so that's out.
That's Ellen and Unwin, did you say? And yeah. they're the iceberg people, aren't they too?
Yeah. And Elise as well. So that comes out early next year. And it was a bit of a, I got my first proper grant to do that. So it was with the City of Melbourne, and it was accessing their arts and heritage collection. And they have this big bunker in the city that they have all this memorabilia from the Olympics, and just street posters and all this amazing stuff. So I got, I wrote this very light on plan, and then I got the grant, and then I saw the stuff, but then locked out, like the disaster of the last few years started. But the other half of their collection is the street sculptures, so I didn't feel great going into this bunker and annoying them when we were all terrified of COVID. So I ended up focusing on the street sculptures. And then I also have this really weird interest in big cats, like the they have these stories about these big lions and tigers that have escaped from the circus, and they're in Gippsland and other places.
It was
locked down. So I was like, okay, I've got these three weird combo. I've got to work out this story. And so I wrote this book about this girl that lives in the city in a very linear way, and is a bit of an investigator, but likes things very orderly. And then she lures a big cat into the city with her cans of tuna. And then the cat is one of the wild cat personalities that are in lots of books, but makes her experience the city in a different way. And that was because we were obviously stuck in our neighborhood, and I was always used to going, okay, we go to this playground, we go to this park, we do this. But because we were just so disheveled from COVID and homeschooling, we were like, okay, we have to go and find new ways to experience North Fitzroy. So we'd be like, we found this secret swing that someone had hidden in a tree in this bushland because the playgrounds were closed. So we'd go there, and then, you know, we'd go down to the creek, down muddy cliffs and stuff. And I was just trying to have some sense of inspiration and fun in this really tough time. So anyway, that was all those factors came together for the book. So it was really enjoyable.
It sounds gorgeous.
I'm pretty excited about it, but it's yeah. Now I have to come up with a new weird combo, and I hope.
And also, you know, it sounds like it combines all your interests and all your loves, and clearly you have a strong connection with nature.
Yeah,
and that comes through in all your work as well, and in that narrative as well. Yeah. Oh, it's amazing. Yeah. And you know, hooking up with the right people, putting yourself in the right place, doing all the courses, doing all the things, like just keeping working on it.
I used to get, like I was saying, at high school, how I sort of stopped doing art because I saw some of my arty friends were just so much better.
Oh, I know. It breaks my heart. Yeah.
But it's something that everyone does. But it's the same with this as a job, or, you know, it does feel very like a massive hill that you're not allowed to climb up. But I think where you see flaws in your work, it's just something that you need to go and work on. So it's like doing the courses and going to the conferences or whatever. I just help him fill up that skill set, and it is like you're allowed to do that, and you, if you enjoy it and it feels like like a exciting next chapter, then you should make that change happen. And I think it's very possible with it takes a lot of work, but it's an enjoyable experience anyway, so it's hopefully doesn't feel too much like a grind.
A coach of mine recently said that patience isn't a virtue, it's a strategy. And I thought that's so perfect for what we all do. That patience is, and also I was thinking about patience too, because you know, often to tell people to be patient is like waving a red flag at a bull, like they just want to, you know, charge you. But I think the key a lot of the time too, and from watching you is and listening to you today, is that balancing patience with eagerness. So staying eager and staying curious, even while you know that you may not be exactly where you want to be yet, but you're getting there. And staying eager.
I think all the learning part is part of the
part
joy.
Of the eagerness.
Like I joined Squibby ages ago, but now I'm like the illustration coordinator, and I always still find such a lift from going to the talks and listening to others talk about their path and their experience. It always just fills me with so much energy afterwards.
Camaraderie, so important.
Totally. So I think all that, and then you get to know everyone, you know, that comes to those events, and there's lots of people starting out and lots of people that are very experienced. So it's been a really nice way to develop skills and network and just absorb some amazing info. But I think you can,
and to feel that you're part of something bigger than yourself too.
Yeah, totally.
You can just disappear up your own alleyway.
The duck pond was great as well, because I used to it's so nice when you've got kids and you can't escape to the city for a 4-hour Scooby afternoon, but you can go and quickly have a comment and get some feedback and have nice chats with people online. So that's again.
All these things.
Awesome.
Let me have a look at my scribbles here. Can I ask you about, is it Bologna?
So 13 years ago, I think it was, when I was selling co-editions, I went to Bologna to sell books. And it was like quite.
Was this with 5 Mile?
Yeah. So I would have back-to-back meetings from like 8 till 6, and then you'd be out for Italian.
I've heard that that's the reality of Bologna.
Yeah, so you'd have maybe 10 minutes to eat a sandwich in the tiny backstage part, and then run to the loo. And it was great, but it was almost too much. Like I don't think I'm an extrovert, and I was like, I think I got a bit shell-shocked. I was like trying to meditate in my room to calm myself.
And where was this again? This wasn't Bologna, though. This was Frankfurt, was it?
I went to
this
both.
Bologna. Okay, so sorry.
Either of them, they were both mental. On the last day of Bologna, they said, oh, you've got a free half an hour. And I was like, oh, my God, I'm going back to the illustrator's exhibition. And I went there and I just started crying. And I was, like, walking around because the work was so beautiful. And I was just like, I just want to be here as an illustrator. I don't have to be in the exhibition, but I want to be back here next time as an illustrator, not selling books. And it was really, like a really spiritual moment. So I came back and continued that job. And then when I left the maternity leave, suddenly 10 years have gone and it's been great. But I thought, when I won the CBCA, you win some money, and I was like, it justified the cost to go. And I was like, I'm just going to think about it. I booked the accommodation. And I was like, I don't know. It feels still a lot. Like, I know it's hard to leave the family and everything. But anyway, I finally bit the bullet and booked the flights like a couple of weeks ago. And it's going to be quick. Like, I have to get there. I think I've got 2 days to unwind and then 3 days, and then I think I've got 2 days and I'm going to do something nice and then back again. So I think the whole thing's 9 days, but I think it's going to be just a great experience, and it's so inspiring to see all this work from around the world. And I won't be obviously selling books, but hopefully I can have some meetings with some of the publishers I've worked with overseas that I've never met before, and just gather inspiration and eat some pasta. And
oh, be beautiful. And are you going on your own?
So there's quite a few illustrators going. So Anna's going, Alison Lester and Jane Godwin, a few of those crew. So I think I'm going to hopefully tag along with some of their fun parts. But we'll see. And then the Australia has a publishing association table or section, like a little booth. And so I'm going to hopefully do some live drawings from their stand. You have to wait and see. Hopefully that works out. And then, I've got a few, because of working in coeditions, there's a few international publishing people that hopefully I can meet up with. And yeah, I don't think I'm going to be lonely, which is good.
Amazing. Yeah. And that's March next year.
Yeah, early March. That's not that far away, really.
And will you be sharing on Insta some of that adventure?
I'll be documenting. Hopefully.
Good.
It's a bit of one of those annoying ones. You're like, bloody person in Italy, you know, all these amazing photos. But I think also I've always loved seeing people's experiences there, because it's just so removed. And
I had that same experience just now with being overseas, and I was very aware I didn't want to be a travel bore, and I'd actually signed off, you know, on going on holiday. And then I got tempted and put one little picture on, and then lots of people came on and said, please share. So
I
tried to contain it, but yeah, that's that dance, isn't it? You don't want to be a dickhead.
I like seeing a couple of photos. It's just, I think, because we've all been so starved of it. And you're excited for people experiencing it, and you hopefully people have got something in the back of their mind for the next few years to go and have one of their own. So it's nice to share it.
So next year is looking big. You've got Bologna at the sort of at the beginning of the year. You've got your new, what's the name of the new book?
That's called Big Cat.
That's coming out. So that's your first narrative picture book.
Yeah. And I've got
exciting. And that's with a firm.
No, that's with Ellen and Unwin.
Ellen and Unwin. Yeah.
And then I've got a couple with a firm. I'm working on this book that I'm also really excited about. I think it's gonna be called A Country of Colours. And I wanted to mix art, like basic colour theory and painting and my love for watercolours with Australian nature. And so I've done this mega book, and it's it teaches a little bit about colour theory, and then it goes into the rainbow. So there's a red section, an orange section, and it's all plants and animals. And I've got a scientist friend that helped.
Oh, that sounds beautiful.
Yeah, I'm so excited. So it's 48 pages, so that's the biggest I've done. I wrote about 4 or 5 sentences per animal or plant, but then we realized we could only fit in one sentence, so I'm just yoinking out stuff now,
murdering you darlings.
Yeah, but it's really it feels very grand and very I think it's going to look amazing. Christy Lund-White, who I used to work with at 5 Mile, is the designer, and instead of doing roughs for this one, because it's so factual, it wasn't really, you didn't really need to lay it out, but she's now piecing together all these, I think I've done about 200 paintings, and she's piecing together all these pieces and then making it look amazing with her design. So
200 paintings,
all like little ones.
But
it felt like a lot, and it's just so different, so I'm very excited about that.
And that's coming out next year. And who's that with?
With a firm press.
That's a firm.
Yeah.
A firm
are
very, they're a little bit sort of avant-garde, aren't they, in a lot of their approaches? They're playful and brave.
You know, I was used to like going, oh, please, can I have something very basic, like, I don't know, what's it called, the UV on the cover, like something slightly shiny.
Oh, yes, a bit of spot gloss.
I might have said, oh, could I have some, is there any chance of some foil? And they're like, yeah, let's do 3 foils. And they're just, so they're really,
great.
And they get really behind, and I feel like they're really excited about projects. And they've been really, I felt like a real creator almost for the first time. It's probably me getting a bit older, a bit more experienced, but they always treated me with so much respect, and I felt really grateful to work with them, and they've been really behind on my projects. So
you feel valued, and I think when you feel valued, you work better.
Yeah,
absolutely, work better. I love that. There can be a thing that, you know, I've been in the business long enough to notice that sometimes, occasionally, the publishers actually forget that the people that they're working with have arrived. So sometimes they might keep treating a creator as if they're still in the emerging stage, when actually they've got a huge body of work behind them, and there's a bit of a catch up that has to happen sometimes. I'm not saying that's happened to you, but it has happened to different people. And I think those listening, you know, be aware of that. Be aware of where you're at in your career now, and don't play small.
Yeah, but I think also I'm not very good at, I've been very good at talking myself down and being, and I used to do that in my old job as well, like basically telling the world that I'm not great and I'm make, you know, I just would be very
self-effacing.
Yeah, and I think I have to keep telling myself to stop doing that. And I think if you're, even when you're early on, you should always treat yourself with respect and know that you're doing something that has taken a lot of education and work. Even if it looks simple, it's taken a lot of experience to get to that place. So treat yourself with respect and just be great to work with. So get things in ahead of time and always be polite, but don't talk yourself down and try and, like you're
so
doing
important. That's fantastic advice. It's all about self-respect, and then self-respect doesn't mean that you're hard to work with.
Yeah, totally.
At all, just to have boundaries, and it doesn't mean that at all. And you know, in publishing, it's the ones who act professionally, who are prompt, who answer their emails quickly, who don't dick around, who get more work, and who get respect. Yeah,
so true.
And forge ahead.
And you might be learning, especially with your first few books, how it all works. But I think if you come across in a really friendly way, open to suggestions and everything, but also respecting your own art and your own writing, and I think it develops the relationship in a really powerful way versus being the underling that I felt like for many years, and you kind of sometimes do get feel a bit walked over, and then you get a bit resentful, and it's just it doesn't put you in a good place to have a long term. You can't change that. I learned that in my old life. Like, once you cut yourself down and you are that person, you can't suddenly gain respect as you've grown with the job.
It's hard. Oh, it's a fascinating journey. It's not an easy one, and it's not easy because it is so collaborative, and you are so dependent on so many other people for your success, not just on your own efforts. So but again, I love what you've done. I love how you've diversified. I love how you've got multiple income streams. And you just keep experimenting and putting yourself out there. It's so inspiring to talk to you, Jess. And I'm so looking forward to 2023 to see all these things hit the shelves. Super exciting. I was going to say, what's next? But so what is next after next year?
Exactly. Well, I am in a bit of a weird transition phase because I say he started school this year because last year was a write-off. So it's the first year that I've had two kids at school, and it's like I've been working in this very frantic, excited, but like, you know, as you said, I've outputted a lot for the last few years in every crack of time. And it's like I started this year with the same, that's how I work. So I'll be like 5 days a week going, and I was suddenly like, I can't do this, I'm going to fall apart, and it's not healthy, and I don't need to work like this anymore. So I'm trying to learn how to slow down a little bit and have more than just work and my family and play. I'm trying to get more healthy stuff in and do more exercise and go out for lunches with friends because I can. And so I'm relearning like the next chapter and working out what's going to be ahead for my next 10 years, because I feel like 10 years is a good time to go, I've done this great full circle and I'm going to Bologna and I've won this great award and I feel really proud and happy with how those 10 years have gone. But it's like, I don't really know what's next, but I feel like I need to start working that out because it is good to have a little bit of a compass direction.
Also great to recognize the cycles in your life like that. That's half the, you know, half the challenge. And to also allow yourself to learn how you're going to show up in the next phase of your life, in the next season. That's It takes time. You can't just go, oh, right, now I'm here, I'm going to be like this and this is how it's going to work. To take the time. And Bologna will be a lovely punctuation, even though it'll be frantic and quick. It's sort of time out.
It'll be the first time leaving the family for an extended amount of time, and first time on a plane on an international plane for way too long. So, yeah, I think it's going to be a really nice time to reflect and plan.
A friend of mine always says that when you're flying, especially international flights, it's a good time to take stock, because you've got no choice. You know, you're trapped in this tube. But also, she reckons you're closer to God, so you tend to get more inspiration when you're up there.
I always choose
clarity,
because I think when you're sitting up looking out the window, there's like, it's such a weird time. You always have these very philosophical reflections, and so that would be, I have like 20 hours of that. And it'll be really great fun. I can't wait.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
All right. So the best place to find you, Jess, I am thinking, is Instagram.
I've been a bit slowed down on there a little bit, but Instagram's awesome, and I've got a website under Jess's Mess, and that's probably the two places. And I'm going to be
link all those
next weekend if anyone's in Melbourne.
At the what, sorry?
I'm going to this massive big design market next weekend, so I've got a stand.
I think you put that on.
I saw that
somewhere and thought, man, that would be so good.
I did it a few years ago. It's exhausting, but it's really fun to talk to people face-to-face, because otherwise you're just in your little lonely studio all the time. But Renee Tremble's got a stand, and Anna McGregor's got a stand, so it's going to be fun.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah.
That's the Makers Market, is it? Or is it, what is
it's
it called?
It's called the Big Design Market. So it's
the Big Design Market.
The real exhibition building.
Exhibition.
I have, I think, about 200 designer, really nice stuff. So
that go all weekend, Jess?
Yeah, it's Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Oh, right, 3 days.
Looking good around there, yeah.
Yeah, and are you there for every day, for the 3 days?
Yes, and then I turn in past friends, and so I can go to the loo. I'm just like, can you stop? I might run off. It's a bit like the Bologna experience.
Oh, yeah.
It's a bit
full on.
Yeah, it's really full on, but it's pretty, it's a bit of a buzz. You get that adrenaline.
Oh, totally.
Yeah.
I think one of the hardest things about being involved in anything like that is being nice to people all day.
Yeah.
I can never work in hospitality or flight attendant or something. I'd be saying, oh, just piss off and get your own thing.
Some people have stands that you can walk into and they've got nowhere to hide, but I always I've got like some big like my card stand's massive, so if I need a break, I just sit behind.
You can duck behind that.
Yeah, it's just, you need to tune out.
You do, especially for introverts. And All right, Jess, thank you so much for joining us today. I know people are going to get such a lot out of this. They'll probably listen more than once because there is so much to take on and to enjoy, and so many lessons to glean from your journey. So and your beautiful work, we just love seeing it come out in the world. I love your Etsy shop. I've bought gifts there before. In fact, I bought I love your bunny poster.
Oh yeah.
I love that. And I actually bought that for my niece, who is in her 40s, because that's how old I am. But she adores it. Yeah.
I need to do one for chicken breeds next, I reckon, because we get chickens and I love them. And
chickens would be awesome.
Yeah,
because you need another job.
Yeah, totally.
We need another project.
Oh, exactly. Well, thanks, and thanks for all the work that you do, because I was thinking you really have given me a lot, and you continue to for lots of people. So I really appreciate it. And I love how you mix in spiritual stuff and like work business stuff as well as the bookmaking. So it's been great to have a supporter. And I love what you guys do.
It's been fun. It's all been amazing. Yeah. Meet amazing people. You meet amazing people when you step outside your front door and put yourself in the flow, don't you?
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Jess. And we will, we'll put this on, it'll premiere in the Duck Pond for a couple of weeks, which is my private membership site. And then we'll pop it onto YouTube, and then we'll lift the audio as well and stick it on the podcast. So we've got all bases covered.
Thanks.
And I'll put all the links to all the beautiful things down below, of course. So
thank you. I can listen and look and go,
We'll let you get back to it, Jess.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. See you later. Bye.